say this. It should be up on the screen here in a moment. It says this about Jesus coming into the city of Jerusalem. It says, as they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell him that the Lord needs them. Everyone say, the Lord needs them. Don't hear that very often from Jesus. The Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, who is this? Listen, today we want to point to the Christ who came not only to the city of Jerusalem, but who came for you, who came for me. Whether you know Jesus by first name and in everyday life, or you're still searching for him today, guess what? He came for you. He didn't just enter Jerusalem to save a few people. He actually came into this world that all might be saved and know their true identity in God. Today, we're going to take time really to celebrate. We want to just celebrate Jesus with you this morning. Can we do that? Is it okay to make a big deal about Jesus? Can we do that? Let's do that. I'm going to ask you to stand up. And in just a moment, the kids, as I said, will walk in here. But this is going to be a little different. Today, we want to celebrate. We want to celebrate, and we want this whole morning to be about, and it is every week, about Christ. But this is actually an opportunity this week to actually steward and share what Jesus is doing in your life. When we share testimonies and stories of what Jesus is doing, it begins to stir us up. When Jesus enters your life, guess what? Just as the crowds got stirred up in verse 10, the whole crowd was stirred up because Jesus had entered. Guess what? Your life gets stirred up when Jesus enters. All sorts of things get stirred up. Things that once were are now dead. Praise God, because they had no purpose and they had no value. He stirs up new things and brings new things to growth that never, ever you thought possible before. He brings hope where you didn't know there could be hope before. What did he do? He stirred it up. It's a beautiful thing that Christ did. We celebrate Palm Sunday, the entry of Christ into the city to finish what he came for. Let's make a big deal out of him today. The front area, as the kids are going to come up here and celebrate, this whole front area is just going to be open for you to worship. It really is every week, but we welcome you to just step forward and make a big deal about Jesus. Whatever that means to you, you're free to express your love for him. Can you say, no holding back?
No holding back.
Say it again. No holding back. There's no holding back from Jesus. Jesus invites you. He invites you to a freedom and celebration out of his goodness. One of the other gospel writers relating to the triumphal entry of Christ in Luke 19, verse 40. The Pharisees are upset because the crowds were so excited. They were so stirred up about Jesus entering the city. It says that the disciples were joyfully celebrating. And the Pharisees, it's like, Jesus, you got to rebuke those ones that are all excited about you. You gotta tell them to be quiet. You know what Jesus says? If they don't cry out, the rocks will. Listen, don't let it be the rocks today. Let it be you, right? Let it be me. I don't want the rocks to cry. I want to cry out. This is a king we get to celebrate. So today, let hope and love and the truth of God stir up in your spirit. We're inviting you as we worship this morning. Kids are about to come on. Come on in, children. You can go and do your thing. But this is just a time to celebrate. You're welcome up here to dance, to enjoy the Lord. And this mic is going to be here for you to come and share testimonies as we worship, okay? We'd ask that you just kind of stand by the mic. If the Lord is stirring your heart to share testimony, just go ahead and stand right here. There will be breaks in the worship time, and you'll know when it's time to share, okay? Y'all hear that? We want you to have space this morning to be stirred up and to talk about what Jesus is doing. Is that all right? Let's do it together. We celebrate and worship in Jesus' name. So glad that you're here.
Hold on to that. He's everything for us. That's what today's all about. Giving him glory. Raising him up. He's our Savior. God, you're so good. We just love you. Just sing that chorus one more time. You're everything I need. Yes, Lord, we believe that today. You're good.
I want to encourage you to come and give testimony as we just open up, because the words of your testimony seed something into the heavens. All of us are seeds, and God has planted us, and things that we do, when you give a spoken word, it plants a seed. When everything we do, we're doing things to be able to build the kingdom of God, and God entrusts us into that. So if anyone has a testimony that they would like to start off with, it's not a preach, it's just a testimony. What, anybody has a good story that you can share real quickly about a God story about through our time together? Would someone just come on up right now and we'll start you off? Here we go. And let's just, as someone's sharing, let's give an applause to God. And let's just hear God's stories that are going on.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you. Can I just say that I love, love, love all you guys. All right. So, my God encounter. I had been praying in the spirit for a guy at work that had a stroke, and his whole one side is paralyzed. But he managed to drive and come to work to my place every day, and I had been praying in the spirit for him for a few days. And he happened to be there, and I was praying in the spirit. All of a sudden, the waitresses come yelling to me, "Harvey, Harvey, somebody needs help in the bathroom." And I'm like, "Oh, it must be." All right, I ran to the bathroom, and it was him. And I'm like, "Whoa, God, whoa, right?" And it was really, really awkward, okay? It was really awkward, okay? He had a mess everywhere. God just caused me to start praying for him right there, and it was amazing. And then I was able to walk him to his car, and he received salvation, and it was amazing, amazing.
Thank you, God. Well, this morning we're going to continue to worship, but as we do, we're going to do something a little bit different with our tithes and offerings. We're going to be able to, as our worship to the Lord, and as you take it as a seed, as your offering, whether it be tithes or offerings, we're going to have you come as an act of worship as we're singing and just place it in the box up here. If you're visiting with us, don't feel any pressure. This is just a time that we're celebrating the Lord. But I want us to think about something, because Paul talked about seed to the early church. In fact, they're preparing for an offering because he was sending some guys out to an area with the church, and they were going to just see how God was going to be amazing in that place as they were spreading the word of God in his kingdom. And so he wrote to the church in Corinthians, and he says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 9. He says this, and he says, "So I thought it necessary to urge the brothers to visit you in advance and finish the arrangements for the generous gift that you had promised. Then it will be ready as a generous gift, not as one grudgingly given. Now here he says, remember this, and I believe he's saying, remember this, that this is a kingdom principle. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. We should be happy about what we give to God, what we give as an offering, what we give to other people. It should be a joy that God has first given us. And so we just take that love, that joy, and we're able to bless other people with it. There's a kingdom principle that happens in that. And then it says this, it continues going, and God is able to bless you abundantly. Can you say abundantly? Abundantly, so that all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. Isn't that a promise from heaven? So I think that sometimes we put a curse on ourselves because we just hold back. Well, I can't afford it. I can't do that. And all of a sudden we lose a blessing, I believe, that God has for all of us. In the way that he blesses us, we're able to bless others. He says, and as it's written, they have freely scattered their gifts to the poor. Their righteousness endures forever. He connects righteousness with an attitude of a giver. Wow. So as you become a giver of your money to other people, there's a righteousness that's connected to it. It doesn't make earthly sense, but it's kingdom sense. And then he says, now he, who's he? It's God. Now he, God, who supplies seed. So who supplies the seed for us to sow? God supplies it to us. And the bread for the food will also supply an increase. Everyone say increase. An increase. Your store of seed that will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. I mean, this is just one after another. It's just positive upon positive. You will be enriched in every way so that you're generous on every occasion. And through your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. Why is that? It's because when we give, there's a blessing that's involved. Not only does that get blessed, and as you give to the church, we're blessed by what you give. We're able to bless others also. But it's not only that, a generous heart, and I see it done with so many of you. We do this as a church. I see where people sow and give and bless other people. They see a need, and they try to take care of it. It's a spirit of generosity that is birthed within us. And this says, this service, in the service of giving that you perform, is not only supplying the needs of the Lord's people, but also an overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Because of this service by which you have proved yourselves, others will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and for your generosity in sharing with them, with everyone else. And in their prayers for their hearts will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given to you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. We can never outgive God. Why? It's because he's the supplier of that in the first place. Amen. And when we give out of the right heart, and God, I believe, honors that in so many ways. Maybe your car lasts longer. Maybe your clothes last longer. Maybe things just have more abundance in those kind of areas because of our generosity of giving. So let's just take a moment of prayer, and just I would just ask God, what is it this morning that God would like you to seed into the offering? And it's not guilt. It's not anything. If nothing, that's fine. I just want you to be obedient to the voice of God. And then it's just an expression of worship. Just come and put it in the offering box, just saying, Lord, it's yours, God. Here, take it. I'm glad to give to you this morning. So, Father, we ask that you bless those who are giving the offering this morning. And that, Father, in our giving and in our seeding, that, Lord, it would multiply. It would be a blessing to others. And then even in that blessing, then, Lord, I would have an increase of abundance in my life. And, Lord, I know I do. I'm so blessed by you, Father. And I'm so happy to be a follower of you. I'm so happy to be someone who's taken kingdom living and try to live that out. And so, Father, we pray for your encouragement. We pray for your blessing. We pray for your provision in all our lives. And, Lord, we know it's not a mouth, but it's a heart that gives. That's what's so important. And so, Lord, as we just continue to worship you this day, we ask, Father, for your kingdom to come on earth as it is in heaven. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. So let's give God a clap. Let's stand up and worship the Lord
awesome.
Some more.
Yeah, don't be afraid to wave the palm branches around. Dance if you want to. As you're coming up to give your offering, be free today.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. And hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Jesus. Let's go.
someone's heart is burning to share, this mic is waiting for you to steward and welcome Jesus to get glory, more glory in what's happening. So someone's testimony, it could be a story of your salvation. This isn't just have to be today or last week. It could be, man, let's stir up what Jesus has done.
I just want to share something that happened over the weekend. Lucy and I had a meeting in Long Island. And if you ever been to New York City, there are these things called ZZ Pass, and you get over the bridges and cash things to go over. Well, we don't have an ZZ Pass because we don't need it. But we got in the cash line, and we're sitting there, and it's bumper-to-bumper traffic. You know, hours in line, and we noticed in the aisle that was sort of next to us, maybe two over, up the vehicles up above, and all of a sudden, here we are getting ready, probably four or five car lengths to get in to do the cash, and this door opens, and this little boy gets out, and he's stomping his feet. He must have been 14, 15 years old. He's stomping. He is really upset, mad. He gets the door, and he's slamming it against the car. Then he gets back in. That sort of got our attention. I know New York City is weird, but I didn't realize it was. But anyway, to make a long story short, he got it and did it again. We moved a little farther, and people were kind of looking at this kid. And they were fighting inside physically. And I said, well, what's going on here? And obviously, you can't get out and start asking what the problem is. Okay? But it looked like some dispute between a father and a son. And it seemed probably very common. And the only thing I could think about was, Lord, why am I here recognizing that? And it was to pray. Very simply, James 5 says, if you're in trouble, you pray. That family needed prayer. I don't know who they are. They had New York license plates. I couldn't get out and do anything. But it seemed like God placed us there to pray. And so I thought about that, and I said, okay, Lord. So we prayed. Lucy and I prayed for them. So maybe it's encouragement. You may find yourself like that, but that was just really, I think, a God moment. And he called me to do it. He called us to pray.
Sure. I've tried to plan this all week, and I couldn't write it, so I'm just going to trust God to say what we've been wanting to say. Most of you know Jim's been battling cancer for about 5 years, but this is praise and testimony of you, the body. What you have done for us through this trial, error, whatever, the prayers, the moral support, the times when I've cried because I was so angry at God. I remember the first time he was diagnosed, Bev, scream, no, Satan, you can't have him. And he's here. And he's here because of you, because of the body. And we just want to say thank you and don't give up yet because he's still struggling. But, you know, Satan has tried everything. This new medicine he's got to go on. It has a ridiculous copay of $3,200 a month. And they want him on for 6 to 8 months. And we looked at each other like, what are we going to do? You know? And then God said, remember, you went to school. You got a bachelor's degree in business management. You didn't get to use it in the work world. They fired me every time I went because Jim got sick and I would go home. But it gave me the knowledge to know where to turn, where to go. And, you know, we don't have to pay a penny for this medicine. It is provided. So,
Okay, I got one more. So there's somebody here, and you know who you are. You've come very dear to my heart that had been praying, and you came on my heart, and you had a vision of me getting an increase in finance, and it happened this week.
Yay for Mike's Jesus. Hey, I want to just encourage anyone who's just feeling compelled to actually, if a few of you want to go and actually pray with Jim right now, I think, you know, if you hear something and the Lord stirs your heart up, there's freedom in the spirit of the Lord to just go. You don't have to have a degree. You don't have to have a letter behind your name. It's just the freedom in the Lord. So just as the Lord leads you, if there's a few people who want to just place hands on Jim, as we are continuing to believe every good thing that Christ has for you. Yeah, love you guys. Yeah. Let's continue to worship as well. Thank you, Jesus. We'll try to keep this mic here.
This God is our healer, amen. He's good. He's great. There's none other like him. Let's just continue to lift that up about him this morning.
Power of God, you are God. And
believe you're the healer. Stronger in everything.
You're our God, our God.
Slow. Those are words to hold on to. Those are His promises. Again, we just invite you to come up and share whatever is on your heart.
The Lord's telling me, better get up there now or else you're going to think it to death, okay? Today's about Jesus coming in, into the city, and I just want to testify. I just want to testify for what He did for me. That Jesus, you came and you got me on the other side of the world in a little room in an island way up north. And I just thank you, Jesus, that you came and you opened my eyes. And there's no explanation to it other than you came and you got me. Thank you, Jesus.
Been reading through Hebrews this week, and Hebrews chapter 7. This Melchizedek was king of Salem and priest of God Most High. He met Abraham returning from the defeat of the kings and blessed him, and Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. First, the name Melchizedek means king of righteousness. Then also king of Salem means king of peace. Without father or mother, without genealogy, without beginning of days or end of life, resembling the Son of God, he remains a priest forever. And then further down it says, if perfection could have been obtained through the Levitical priesthood, and indeed the law given to the people established that priesthood, why was there still a need for another priest to come, one in the order of Melchizedek, not in the order of Aaron? For what when the priesthood is changed, the law must change also. He of whom these things are said belonged to a different tribe, and no one from that tribe has ever served at the altar. This is a day where we celebrate the fulfillment of the Old Testament passages, which Hebrews is relating to here. This is the day where we celebrate that the priest king, entered into Jerusalem. And he was proclaimed as king, but he's also a priest in a different order than the Jews understood the priests. He serves as both. He is our priest king.
I'd like to give a little testimony on tithe and offering. Back before I met the Lord, I used to go to church and I put my dollar in place so everybody could see that I did it. And after I met the Lord, I started tithing. And the last 3 years on my taxes, one-third of my income goes to the Lord's work, plus what I give out of my pocket when I see a need. So I've just been blessed. Last weekend, I was in Chesapeake, Virginia, visiting my family, and they had a tornado come our way. And I spoke to that tornado. I commanded it to get out of here. It came through. I got one church down there, and it also got some places in town. But we were spared. Praise the Lord.
I just want to give thanks for God, for Jesus. I mean, you're looking at me, but if you could see me back then, this smothered in sin, didn't know what to do. didn't even like me. Have you ever gathered and looked in the mirror and knew you didn't like what you saw? Didn't know where to turn. Listen to the world, the advice they was giving me. Go on the worldly route. I think back from childhood. I look back. Honestly, I shouldn't be here. But God, yes, He kept me. He hold me. Yes. I look back at my friends that's not here. But God, He kept me. I just want to thank Him. I could just take the whole rest of the service. You know where He brought me from. You know the man I used to be. I was nowhere. I was nothing until I came to know Jesus. He's a God that you have to come to Him earnestly. No program, no steps. Just come as you are. That's how I came to Him. I remember that moment when I dropped to my knees. Lord, I came to Him. Lord, I'm doing things I don't want to do, but I'm doing it when I don't want to do it. And He took it away. And I know I never look back. And I just have to thank Him. It just, how great is He? How great is He? How He kept me. Thank you, Jesus.
Speaking the Father's name.
us out. Light in this broken land. It's all authority. Every victory is yours. It's all.
Thank you. praying for you right now. Look at them. Look them in the eye. These are, hey, these are your sisters. These are your sisters. They're not accusers. They're lovers. They love you. You're family. So I want all you to hug them all. Let's hug her. Let's sing while she gets hugged. Let's sing.
Let's sing We Will Overcome. Just as a declaration over her life and over all these testimonies.
And we will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. And we will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony.
At work and, you know, bring some puppy therapy to the office. And he actually drags me over to this girl's office and is like, tell her about the DMs. Tell her about what Tuesday nights and what's happening there. And all that kind of came out of some physical injury for him and my mom, just keeping them close to home and not really active. It's been a really frustrating time for him. But out of that physical harm that was there, he's really just kind of opened his heart to the Lord through that, because he had the time and space. He was kind of forced to do that. So he's like, oh my gosh, my mom is Laura. Laura, how can we give more? How can we live on less and give more? And I'm just like, who are you? It's awesome. So I think the change that happens in one person in a family can spread to the rest of the family. In Jesus' name. So, thank you, Lord.
Blood from
inside which flow and be a sinner. Double cure, save from wrath, make me pure. And not the labors of my hands can fulfill.
it, so I don't normally do this. So I've been working in the hospital for about 7-8 months, and one of the things I noticed was Jesus really isn't there, not in my department. It wasn't really anyone. There was like one person that I talked to, but he was, you know, just like me. I was just like, you know, holding it in to myself. And so there was one person that I was praying for, who I was pretty close to, one of the nurses. And this past month, I've really been focusing on Jesus' words. I think when it all boils down to it, I think you guys can agree that it's all about Jesus, right? So I started reading, and something really, you know, kind of hit me pretty hard. You know, I've been there for 7 months, hadn't said a word. I'm like a nice guy. I try to be, but I need to say Jesus, you know, and then they'll know. So, like a week ago, I read in Matthew, "You are the light of the world, a city set on a hill that cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." And so, I was, for the past 7 months, I was just being a good guy, and that's kind of given me glory, you know, because, oh, I'm such a nice person. But I was just praying after that, and I also read, you know, Jesus saying, it was like something about whoever loses their life will find it, and whoever gains their life in this world will lose it, right? So I was just like, God, I want to lose my life for you. I want to lose it all to you. I don't really care what people say now. I don't really care what people think. And so this was like a week ago, and I was praying this. And then the next day, I kid you not, the next day, the nurse who I was praying for sat down next to me and just started, just randomly. I think she knew I was a Christian, whatever. I never said that. I think they knew I go to church, but she was just like, "So, I believe in God, I think, but I have a King James Bible or something, and I can't really understand it." And I was like, "Well, like, there are other translations." And so I ended up giving her a Bible, but that I was just like, you know what, listen, like, I haven't really said this, but, like, don't focus on, like, doctrine stuff, like, really complicated things. Just focus on Jesus. And because that's all it boils down to. All we need is Jesus. And I was just trying to, like, you know, repeat some of the things Jesus said, you know. "I didn't come to the world to condemn the world, but to save it," and all this stuff like that. And it was so awesome, and I felt so, you know, peaceful about that moment. And that's in the nurse's station, and I knew everyone else could hear the conversation, but I was only talking to her. And then around the corner in the office, one of the social workers comes out, and she says, you know, like, she says a comment about, "Well, I struggled with, you know, doctrinal stuff." And then in the break room, she was asking me, "What were you talking about?" And I was just like, "We're just talking about Jesus." You know, that's all it is. You know, Jesus, that's all you need. You know, you don't need to get all the theology, right? You don't need to go to theology school. Like, it's, you know, just love Jesus. And I just needed to praise God about that. So.
Very nervous. I've never spoken in front of anybody. chair, and I'm praising God, and I'm singing, and God says to me, you better get up there, because you got something to say, and I'm going, no. And then a little girl came up. My higher power took me out of my addiction 18 years ago, took me out of the gutter, and brought me here. And I go to AA. I was going to church. I grew up in church. I'm not religious. I'm spiritual. And I got depression really bad and social anxiety. I stopped riding my motorcycle. My husband bought me a trike. Stopped riding the trike. And I pray to God every day to show me who to help and how to help them. I just feel that little girl needs my help, and I'm willing to help her. And I thank God every day for what He's given to me. Every day I get on my knees. Thank you.
Do I dare? Okay. So the last 2 weeks, let me put it down on paper. Why fasting for me, I asked. So you get a call from somebody and you usually just turn your attention to that person because they called you. So you're like, yeah? Well, that's what happened. The Lord had called me to fast. And why? Well, I didn't know until I exercised trust. And I stepped into His idea, His request, and His perfect plan. His perfect plan would only be received if I held back my insight, my needs, and my interpretation of what life should be. I note this because I had already had events on my calendar that called for social eating. So my brother was retiring as the fire chief of the volunteer fire department, and we were to pay per person to attend this event. So I thought, oh, I'd have to break my fast for that. And then I co-hosted an awards ceremony at work, and we were to attend the reception, and after every ceremony, we do a recap, and we talk about how dining services did for the reception, and talk about whether the food was good and everything. I'm fasting. I'm going to have to break my fast for that. So then my aunt passed away, and my other aunt called and said, so how many of you will be attending the luncheon after the funeral? And I'm like, ooh, yeah, I have to break my fast for that one, too. So, and then finally yesterday, like, who goes to New York City without having a slice of pizza? Going to have to break my fast for that, too. Well, before each of those events, the Lord had asked me, would you turn your attention away from me for physical food? He said to me, my dear love, I have spiritual food that's going to fill you and it's going to sustain you so much longer. He gazed upon me and he asked me to lean fully into his spiritual reliance. So at each event, I was excited to be whisked away in my time, in my true love's care and guidance. So I went to each event. No, I didn't eat. And fasting is really pretty good. I mean, it's okay because I had my attention turned to the right call. So in the book, Awaken. I've been reading bits and pieces of it, and it says, agreement with God brings us to a place where we say, yes, Lord, it is for your glory that I live. I want your will to be done in my life alone, above all else. So the Lord has been so good and faithful as he puts some heavy, deep, and real relationships in order in my life. As he does this, I have received unexplainable peace.
Good morning, church. So I just want to testify to God's goodness in the midst of our struggle. I feel like a lot of times, I know for me, and I'm saying this because I'm in the process of it, a lot of times we can get sidetracked by, I want to be here by this point, or why is this happening? I didn't think I would have been at this point in my life. And I just want to read something to you guys from Jeremiah 31. I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have drawn you with an unfailing kindness. I will build you up again. And then later on it says, they will come with weeping. They will pray as I bring them back. I will lead them beside streams of waters on a level path where they will not stumble. They will be like a well-watered garden, and they will sorrow no more. I will turn their mourning into gladness. I will give them comfort and joy instead of sorrow. So I just want to encourage all of you guys, because I know that it's so easy for us to come to church and to smile and pretend like we're okay. And I just want to encourage you all to go before the Father, to go before him. And if you're angry with God, let him know. Talk to your Father. That's why he says that we're our Father and we're to come before him as children and to be childlike before him, to just lay it all at his feet. And it says that he will turn our mourning into gladness. So let's hold on to that truth, church. Let's hold on to that assurance that God is our Father and he will redeem us and he'll restore us for that. Let's hold on to the truth that we will be a garden and we will sorrow no more. So, yeah.
I wasn't going to get up, but with that, I've been just impressed all morning, and these thoughts are coming to me that the Lord said, I am not a man that I would lie. And he also said that wait for the vision. Even though it tarries, it will come. And his promises are true.
Hello. So I just wanted to say my little brother on my dad's side has a debilitating disease called Hunter syndrome. And I was just wondering if you would pray for him. And I know that someday when he gets older, he'll be able to do whatever he wants and not have to be held back and go to treatments every month or worry about getting sick, because God will heal him. But I just want to ask if you guys could pray for him.
Thank you.
Syndrome, and I know that you can heal him because you've always helped me when through tough times and everything, and I don't think I could have done it without you. So just touch him and take away the Hunter syndrome, and let the doctors say that they can take the board out of his stomach instead of having to put a new one in. Medicine that has to be transferred through him, put your blood in it, and make sure he knows that you can heal him and that you love him. And I'll try my best to tell him about you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Testimony I should have given a long time ago just went by. I remember back when we had tent revivals up at the fairgrounds, Wayne Williams and some of those guys. Well, one guy was a pastor coming to church this Sunday morning, and he called me out. He said, somebody's having problems with their heart stopping. I was having problems with my heart stopping. And the Lord gave him the word of knowledge that this was happening. He said he worked with Ken Hagin, and Ken Hagin showed him different things about faith and what have you. So anyway, well, he was talking about that before he even touched me. I felt God touch me in my heart. I felt the Spirit. I felt the touch of God in my heart before this even happened. And God spared me for this reason. And I think for this reason alone, since then, I've had the opportunity to lead many people to the Lord Jesus Christ. I even see him walking down the road, and I said, Lord, if they're still there, they were knocking on doors, give me the chance to talk to them. And I'd stop and I'd talk to them. Four people, I led three to the Lord that very same time, you know. As I'd be walking down the street, I'd ask God to open doors for me. The neighbors would come out, they're having problems. So I'd pray with them. I'd pray about their problem, and I'd get the chance to lead them to the Lord. But since this has happened, the Lord has allowed me to lead many people to the Lord, and I thank God, because the Bible says in Proverbs 11:30, fruit of righteousness is a tree of life, and him that winneth souls is wise. Lay up our treasures in heaven. Don't let the tide, in another song that always gets through my mind, faded years, oh how foolish. We spend our lives looking at the things that are not as though they're gonna last forever. They're just gonna decay and fall away. The only thing that's gonna matter is the treasures we lay up on heaven. Lead people to Jesus while you still have life in your body. That's the most important thing, is getting people to God. That's what it's all about. That's why we're here. That's why we're born, to serve him. Without serving him, there's no life. There's no life. Oh, how foolish we are. How foolish we are. We just look at the things. We got to have new cars. We got to have this. We got to have that. So we spend our life just wasting the things that are going to rot and decay instead of things that are eternal. And that's what's the most important thing of all, is getting people to God and winning souls. That's what's wise. And Father God, I thank him for the privilege I have every day to walk my neighborhood, to pray over my neighbors, pray over the hundreds of prayer requests that I have every day, pray over the people in the church. And God uses these things. He'll open the doors for you if you just give them. I've had a chance to even lead people to Jesus that were on their deathbed. They'd call me on the phone and say, he's ready to die. And I would have the chance to lead them to Christ. And this is what it's all about, to give God the glory for the privilege we have to serve him in all our days, and thank him for the privilege to save my life, because I wouldn't have been here if it wasn't for the guy having the word of knowledge and God using him through Ken Hagen to bring me to my healing. Even before he touched me, God had touched me. God had touched me. To God be the glory. For him, for him, for him, we live and breathe and have our being. And thank him for the privilege we have to lead people to Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
You got to stand. We're going to go ahead and close our morning out with a final song of worship here. And, just celebrate. Honor the Lord in all that he's doing.
Yeah, we've had a lot of awesome testimony this morning. And I just encourage you, if you are in the middle of one, come up front. It's open. Now's the time. Don't wait.
And are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. And have you come to the end of yourself? And do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood. Behind your regrets and mistakes, come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling, and bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born, and Jesus is calling. Come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Come to the altar. Forgiveness.
Isn't he good? He is very good. In every circumstance, in every situation, in every moment, he's good. You see, when we begin turning to the people that he destined us to be, a people who, with everything in them, celebrate the excellencies of his glory and grace, and we look and we go, God, you are so perfect. And I have everything to thank you for. When we do that over and over and over, then we begin identifying with who we were created to be. A people who worship and honor the God that created them in love and pleasure. So I say, way to go. I'm just saying, way to go. A heavenly hand clap. A heavenly affirmation of saying yes this morning and coming. Now when you go out at the beginning of this, I remind you that. And Jesus, as he walked and rode rather into the city of Jerusalem, and the disciples were cheering and all this, the Pharisees were scoffing and telling the disciples, Jesus, you need to tell those disciples to be quiet. Jesus said, well, if they don't, the rocks will. So now when you walk by a rock today, go, you thought it was going to be you. I'm crying out. I'm the one talking about Jesus. It's not going to be you. You understand? We are so honored to celebrate with you this week. We want to welcome you back next Sunday for our Easter service. We're going to have an amazing time celebrating God again.